Revelation chapter 8. We will study now the opening of the seventh seal. And as you know, as we have been teaching, the first thing that happens on earth after the rapture of the church in Revelation 4, 1 and 2 was the opening of the first seal. And we believe that white horse rider there in verses 1 and 2 of chapter 6 was or will be indeed the revelation or the revealing of the Antichrist, followed by the red horse, which we believe, and it is our view, is the coming war with Russia, who is certainly making news this day and time in the Middle East. And then we have the black horse, which is famine, which follows war. And the fourth seal, which is a pale horse, which represents death, which follows war and famine. And then we have the fifth seal, which is an account of souls that are under the altar. And he's talking about dead and death and those that were slaughtered during the time of the Great Tribulation, a great slaughtering, and these people are Jews. And then when we study the sixth seal, then begins the supernatural wrath of God, in which God begins to pour out His judgments upon the earth. And when the sixth seal was opened in Revelation chapter 6, then we studied chapter 7, and then the Lord stopped His pouring out of His wrath upon the earth until that He had sealed 144,000 Jews in their foreheads, and we taught that that seal was a revelation of who He was to the Jews, that they might be instructors, and would instruct the Jewish people against the beast and His image and the mark of the beast. And after that takes place, then it brings us to chapter 8. And the opening of the seventh seal. Remember this book that we studied in Revelation chapter 5 when John was caught up into heaven? Revelation chapter 4 and chapter 5. He saw a lamb, then he saw a book that was sealed on the backside with seven seals, and a cry was made, "Who is worthy to open the seals thereof?" And one was weeping and said, "There's not a man that was worthy to open the seals." And the Bible said, "Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah has prevailed." And that was Jesus Christ, and it was He that began to open up the seven seals. In verse 1 of Revelation chapter 8, "And when He had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour. Now, in studying and researching just that verse itself, concerning that particular phrase, that there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour, I've read a lot of thoughts and theories on that and just what that represented. But I have never found an answer to that in Scripture as to why that there was a pause. If a half an hour there is on our time scale, it would be 30 minutes. So any answer to that would just be a theory, someone's belief. You hear the adage sometimes, it's the calm before the storm. I heard one prophecy teacher teach that it was that. You know, it was just the calm before the storm. Certainly, there's no Bible for that as that being what verse 1 of chapter 8 represents. So, in short, we just don't know. We don't know what it means. There are things that are written in this book that we won't know until it is all said and done. So, if you hear someone, I remember I've told this several times, actually my uncle, who was a preacher, told me this, and years and years ago, and the Bible speaks, and we'll get into it later on, about the thunders. And John was commanded when he heard the thunders not to write about them. And He told me, he said, him and a buddy of his heard of a preacher somewhere in Ohio somewhere who knew what those thunders was. So, out of curiosity, they loaded up and went to hear him. See what those thunders was. And he said when they got there, well, that fellow didn't know no more about it than they did. So, but I said, well, you should just save yourself a trip. Because if the Bible wanted us to know, it would have told us. And it's the same way with this verse, this passage in verse 1. If he wanted us to know what is happening during that 30 minutes per se, or that half an hour, he would have just told us. Either it's not really significant, or maybe it is, and we'll just learn about it. But anyway, there are things we just need to leave alone. You know, just if it ever enters into your mind, where did God come from, just leave that alone. Because the only answer to that is that he didn't. That ain't much of an answer, is it? Not to have to comprehend in our feeble minds is to the origin of God. Because to us in the natural, everything has an origin. Everything has a beginning. But it does not hold true to God. Because God had no beginning. He had no origin. And that's hard to conceive in our feeble minds. Because we just naturally, everything does. So, where did God come from? He didn't come from anywhere. You know, it's hard to imagine that concept, that thought, let alone to understand it. So thoughts of that nature, we just leave alone, and we just believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. I know there's a passage in Scripture that says, and I've had to explain it to people, God came from Teman. And I've had some these fellows that really thought they was in depth in the war of the Lord, tell me where God came from. I said, where? Well, the Bible says God came from Teman. And I said, I know, I've read that. I said, you know what Teman means? It just means the south. And in that particular context of Scripture, it wasn't talking of his origin, but perhaps the direction he would have been coming from at that instant in time. As such as when the wind blows, sometimes I guess it blows northward, sometimes southward, eastward, and westward. And then one could say that God comes from the north, and that's all that phrase meant. But those things, we should not even dwell upon those things. But on into this study tonight in verse 2, after this half an hour of silence, he said, and I saw the seven angels which stood before God, and to them were given seven trumpets. Now, one thing I want you to understand about verse 2 that is significant is the fact that these seven trumpets are contained within the seventh seal. Now, why is that important? There's a lot of Bible prophecy teachers teaches that there are 21 judgments of God, seven seals, seven trumpets, and seven vials, or some called bowls. Well, that don't hold true here because we know that he just now is opening the seventh seal. And these seven trumpets are confined within this seventh seal, making the seven trumpets actually the seventh seal. So, if you really want to get technical about it, it is still seven judgments. If you really want to get technical about it, it would only be 13. I mean, that's just math, right? I mean, you can't get 14 out of seven is contained within the seventh. It's impossible. Numerically, it can only be 13. But anyway, that's just things that I think about sometimes, especially when I hear somebody say there's 14 judgments or there's 21 judgments. Is it really significant? No. All that God's going to do, it's just good for thought. I've always felt this way about studying. In anything that I study, I want to know exactly what it means. I want to know the true meaning. I don't want to guess about anything. And if there's an answer to anything or any passage that I don't understand, then I want to search the Scriptures until I find it. And then when I search the Scriptures and there's not a biblical answer given, then we answer it just that way, as we did in verse 1, that there is no biblical answer given, and just leave it alone. If God wanted us to know, He would have told us. But in this seventh seal, He said, "And I saw seven angels which stood before God, and to them were given seven trumpets." So these seven angels with these seven trumpets are confined within this seventh seal of this book that the Lamb has opened. And He says in verse 3, "And another angel." So this angel is not one of those seven. Okay? "And another angel came and stood at the altar having a golden censer." Now, a censer is a little object that they put incense in, and they would burn that in the temple as a sweet smell unto God. Now, if you'd notice, if you'd watched any of the Pope's visit while he was over here during their masses and things, and even the Pope himself did it, he would cut a little thing on a chain, and smoke would be coming out of it, and they'd be wagging it back and forth. Well, that was incense. And they get that from the works of the priests in the tabernacle and temple. I don't know how the Pope could not know this, but we don't have to burn incense today. Actually, that's a type of prayers. It's a type of the Spirit of God. You even notice the dress that they wear, the Pope's outfit, this big long garb of a robe, this high hat he has on. Well, the priests under the law dress that way. And they're trying to hang on to parts of the law, which is not necessary. But another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer. And there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all saints upon the golden altar, which was before the throne. Now, understand that John is seeing things that is transpiring during that 7 years of great tribulation upon the earth. And the question here in verse 3 is who are these saints that he's making a reference to in verse 3? Is it all saints as is inferred in this scripture? No. It is a particular group of saints. And we've already read about them and studied about them. We find them in Revelation chapter 6, verse 9, 10, and 11. "And when he had opened the fifth seal," that was after the riding of the pale horse, which was death, and hell followed him. "And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls," and that tells us that these were dead people. It makes reference to the souls. "And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held." These are the very people that when we read in Revelation chapter 7 that he stopped his wrath from being poured out, that he could seal 144,000 Jews or give them a revelation, a true revelation of who Jesus Christ was, that they might instruct Israel not to worship the beast, nor his image, nor receive his mark. Many of them will be slaughtered. The Bible says these people were slain. What for? For the word of God and for the testimony they held. And a lot of people ask me about salvation during the time of great tribulation. The plan for salvation during that 7 year period won't be water baptism. They won't have to be baptized in water. They won't have to be filled with the Holy Ghost. There is no dress style that they'll have to conform to during that period of time. The Bible says and that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That reference was made, I believe, by Joel to the Jewish nation of Israel. And why don't they have to be baptized? Why don't they have to be filled with the Holy Ghost? Number one, this church dispensation ends at the rapture. As when Jesus Christ was nailed to the cross, the law was fulfilled. Nobody had to live under law no more. Once the rapture takes place, the times of the Gentiles ends. Nobody has to be baptized after that. Nobody has to have the Holy Ghost after that. Nobody has to live holy after that as far as having a dress code. That dispensation will have ended. In the next 7 years, salvation is only promised to the Jewish nation of Israel. Things is going to be happening at such a speed that Jesus warned the nation of Israel that when this takes place, that you won't even have time to run into your house and get you a change of clothes. You won't have time to get nothing. You'll have to flee for your very lives. They won't have time to go to a church. They won't have time to get baptized. They won't have time for these things. He even warned them. He said, pray that your flight be not in the winter. It's going to be so bad and so swift. Pray, or woe be to them that get stuck in those days or have infant babies that is not weaned yet, because it's going to happen that fast. That's why one of the reasons the plan for salvation with Jews during that time is not circumcision the way it was under the law. It's not being born again of water and spirit as it is in this dispensation. But all they'll have to do is call upon the name of the Lord, meaning they accept that Jesus Christ that Israel rejected for the past 2,000 years as Lord and Savior, and they will be saved. That's why Paul said, and all Israel shall be saved. That's what he said. So that is the plan for salvation. These souls here will be Jewish people that will be killed because they refused the mark of the beast, refused to worship the beast. And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. Verse 10. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, doest thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? Verse 11. So we know with that this is a future event. And they are speaking of a time when they were slain, a specific period of time in which they lived. And white robes were given unto every one of them, and it was said unto them that they should rest yet for a little season until their fellow servants also and their brethren, the Jewish brothers, that should be killed as they were, should be fulfilled. So this is an event that has not yet happened. It is yet in the future. A lot of people think this is talking about Peter, James, and John and all of the Jews that was killed and martyred 2,000 years ago. That's not true. They will be raised at the rapture of the church. The dead in Christ shall rise first. So back to Revelation chapter 8 and verse 4. And the smoke of the incense, which is what we have been reading about, which came with the prayers of the saints, the saints that was crying out to God, how long is it going to be before you avenge our blood, ascended up before God out of the angel's hand. And the angel took the censer and filled it with fire of the altar and cast it into the earth, and there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and an earthquake. The Bible speaks during the time of great tribulation of earthquakes and a great major earthquake that will split three ways. It's going to be probably the greatest earthquake that's ever been known in the history of this planet is yet to become. Certainly will. Verse 6, and the seven angels, which had the seven trumpets, prepared themselves to sound. It's going to be a terrible, terrible time. We can't even begin, really, to imagine what is going to be happening on this earth at this time. I don't believe there's a man could even fathom in his mind the devastation and the destruction. There's already going to be billions of people slaughtered and slain during this time. Now notice what happens in verse 7. At the sounding of the first angel. Kind of amazing to me. I listen to a lot of Bible prophecy teachers. And there's this one particular gentleman I listen to or have. And he says that this angel that we're going to read about in verse 7 has already blown his trumpet. And you'd be surprised that, well, he has a national TV program. And he's teaching, this is his doctrine of eschatology. And part of his teachings are that this first angel has already sounded. Well, if that is true, then the first six seals has to have already been opened too. Because we're now inside the seventh seal. And they happen or are opened in succession one to another. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. That's why they're numbered. I can understand some people. Why do you place numbers on things? 1, 2, 3. Because that is the order. Numbers establishes order or in order of how they are to unfold. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. But you still have people out there saying, no, that's not the way they're going to be open. It seems to me, if I understand some of the message people, and when I reference message people, I'm talking about the followers of Wayne Branham, who I think sometimes these people don't even teach what Branham taught himself. And they somehow or another, in Revelation, I believe, 10 and 7, the seventh angel, I believe, in fact, in this group of angels, he is indeed William Branham. That's amazing to me. So do you really believe that? I believe it's Revelation 10 and 7, if my mind serves me right. Yes. But in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he shall begin to sound, the mystery of God shall be finished, as yet declared to his servants the prophets. They emphatically declare and preach for a gospel that seventh angel is William Marion Branham. I cannot even fathom that. I said, you really, really believe that? Yes, sir, absolutely. And I said, well, I'll get back on the subject. These things, they're really not amusing because of the foolishness of it, but it's kind of amusing too. I said, you believe that? Yes, sir. Yes, sir, I believe that. I said, well, I was talking to a particular friend of mine who believes this. I said, I was studying Branham's doctrines and teachings on eschatology. I said, did you know that Branham taught that the church leaves in Revelation chapter 4, verse 1 and 2? So he knew where I was going. I said, now, come on. I said, I'm actually quoting your prophet to you. What he said. I said, he said that the church leaves in Revelation 4, 1 and 2. I said, that ain't all he said. I said, he also said that Revelation 6, 1 and 2 are implied was the Antichrist. I said, now you explain to me how Revelation 10 and 7 gets before Revelation 4, 1 and 2. Didn't have a clue. Did it? Because it destroys their doctrine. Again, the Lord, I know there's things in this Bible hard to be understood, but the things in this book can be understood if we seek God and God gives us revelation and understanding. But we can't go along making up things like Irvin Baxter, and that's who I'm, you may have seen him on TV. He's a prophecy teacher, maybe a very good man, but in my view, he's completely wrong on his eschatology. I just the other night, a fellow from Florida asked me a question openly on Facebook concerning the four horsemen. I didn't answer him openly because I don't want to get into that sort of thing. So he sends me a private message, asked me who I thought they were. Man, then he started posting and posting and posting. I remember I should listen. I said, I've seen that stuff before. I said, you ain't doing a thing but posting Irvin Baxter's works. I said, is that what you're doing? He said, well, I've used some of his works. Man, it looked like his works verbatim to me. But I said, listen. I said, we'll not fall out over this, but I said, I've done studied Baxter's teachings on that, and I said, I do not disagree with him. But Baxter teaches that these things have happened too. Verse 7. The first angel sounded, and there followed hail. Now, you try to imagine in your mind, if you've ever read in history when this has happened. So Baxter says it's happened. The first angel sounded, and there followed hail and fire mingled with blood. Now, this did indeed happen once upon a time. But Baxter, not in on Baxter's chronological scale. The first angel sounded, there followed hail and fire mingled with blood, and they were cast upon the earth, and the third part of trees were burned up. Now, I know these wildfires in California is big and bad. They are. But it ain't going to be nothing compared to this. Now, listen to this. And the third part of trees was burnt up. It's talking about globally on earth. And all green grass was burned up. Has there ever been a time in history when a third part of the trees has been burned up? Absolutely not. So it's impossible for this to happen. I'm going to show you where it did happen once before, but not on a global scale. Exodus chapter 9, verse 22 through 26. This was during the time of the plagues of Moses in Egypt. This only happened in Egypt, not globally. And the Lord said unto Moses, stretch forth thine hand toward heaven, that there may be hail, what we're reading about now, in all the land of Egypt, upon man and upon beast and upon every herb of the field, there's vegetation, throughout the land of Egypt. And Moses stretched forth his rod toward heaven, and the Lord sent thunder, there's the thunder, and hail, and fire, there's the fire, ran along upon the ground, and the Lord rained hail upon the land of Egypt. Was it globally? Verse 7 is globally of Revelation chapter 8. So there was hail and fire mingled with hail, very grievous, such as there was none like it in all the land of Egypt since it became a nation. And the hail smote throughout all the land of Egypt, that all that was in the field, both men, man and beast, and the hail smote every herb of the field and brake every tree of the field. Only in the land of Goshen, that's where God's people were. That's a good point to show that the church had expired from great tribulation. Only in the land of Goshen, where the children of Israel were, was there no hail. So it has happened because Solomon said there's nothing new on the earth. That which is to be has already happened, he said, and it has. But it's talking about the scale. Back to Revelation chapter 8 and verse 8. And by the way, Baxter says if I'm quoting him correctly, and my memory serves me right, that this first trumpet is World War One. That's what he said. Somehow or another, he tried to, I don't equate how many was killed or whatever happened during that time with this. And anyway, it's not even close to being the truth. But and the thing about it is, I was listening to Baxter one night, and seemed like a real good guy, got a good personality about him. And, you know, he's smart in some things. And he said, I used to be like you fellas. I used to be pre-tribulation. He said, in fact, my dad was pre-trib. And was pre-trib when he died. But he saw the light. And I'll tell you a minute. Retain it in my memory how he saw the light. But verse 8, and the second angel sounded, and as it were a great mountain burning with fire, and was cast into the sea, and the third part of the sea became blood, he said. This also has happened previously in history. Exodus chapter 7, verses 19, 20, and 21. Same sequence of events in Egypt. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying to Aaron, take thy rod and stretch out thine hand upon the waters of Egypt, upon their streams, upon their rivers, upon their ponds, upon all their pools of water, that they may become blood, that there may be blood throughout all the land of Egypt, both in vessels of wood and in vessels of stone. And Moses and Aaron did so as the Lord commanded, and he lifted up the rod and smote the waters that were in the river in the sight of Pharaoh and in the sight of his servants, and all the waters that were in the river were turned to blood. And the fish that was in the river died, and the river stank, and the Egyptians could not drink of the water of the river, and there was blood throughout all the land of Egypt. So again, we have this very thing happening, not on a global scale, but locally there in the land of Egypt. Back to Revelation chapter 8. And he says in verse 9, and the third part of the creatures were in the sea, and had life, died. Do you know that two-thirds of the, it's either two-thirds or three-quarters, I don't know if a lot of difference there, but I imagine that there are, of the earth is covered by water, right? Can you imagine how much marine life is in these waters? For a third of them to be killed. This is a time that we can only imagine how bad it's really, really going to be. Really going to be. And the third part of the creatures which were in the sea and had life died. See, once God's anger is poured out, it's not just poured out on man. It's poured out on the fishes of the sea, animals, vegetation. You remember way back in Genesis when God got angry with Adam? He didn't necessarily curse Adam, did he? He cursed the ground. That's right. Now, it affected Adam. Now, when he cursed the serpent, he cursed the serpent. He had to crawl upon his belly. When he cursed the woman, she was cursed. For in sorrow and in conception, she was to conceive and bear children. But the man, he didn't curse the man physically. He cursed the ground for the man's sake. And then put him out in it and said, now, dig out your own food. Plant your own gardens. And when he made the attempt, then it produced thorns and thistles. And then man had to really work by the sweat of his face. You see? So when God gets angry, he really gets angry. And you know, there's people that actually say that God wouldn't do such a thing. And you say, look, I mean, you're going to go to hell. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, the Jehovah's Witnesses, they teach that there is a hell, but people that go there are just instantly burned up. They don't believe in an eternal hell. And again, I don't think that Branham taught that hell was eternal either. But that's not what Jesus taught. Jesus said everlasting. And I don't know what meaning for that. If something is everlasting, there's no end to it. And that is some of the statements and phrases that Jesus made. And yet they say, well, he really didn't mean that. Well, of course he meant that. Hell's going to be for eternity. And in studying the scriptures, eternity is not defined as having a beginning or end. So they're certainly going to be mistaken. That's another thing that really we've preached about hell for years and years and years and tried to convey to people the terrors of hell, but really a preacher can't even convey to people exactly how terrible it's really going to be. And if you want to try to imagine it, try be around an open fire sometime. Then imagine yourself in the midst of that fire. And you can't get out, and you can't burn up either. But Jesus said, where the worm doth not. He referred to humans as worms. Even he himself, the Son of Man, is referred to as a worm. The Son of Man is a worm. He just make reference to that natural body. He said, where the worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. How can you extrapolate from not quenched as to being quenched? I don't understand some of these people. But they teach that. And the third part of the creatures which were in the sea and had life died, and the third part of the ships were destroyed. Think about it. This is the wrath of God. Remember, seal 1, 2, 3, and 4 were acts determined by the activities of man. The sixth seal began the wrath of God, the wrath of the Lamb. Revelation 6, 17 says, for the great day of his wrath has come, and who shall be able to stand? So we have that. That took place in Egypt. In Exodus 7, verse 19, 20, 21, verse 10, 11. By the way, this second angel with his trumpet is World War II, according to Baxter's teachings, which is also false in our head. Verse 10. And the third angel sounded, and there fell a great star from heaven, burning as it were a lamp, and it fell upon the third part of the rivers and upon the fountains of waters. Now, this would be recorded in our history books if something like this would have happened already. You would be able to go to get you a book on history, and you would be able to read of this event, that there was a time that a star, the Bible calls a star, they would call it a meteorite, fell from heaven, struck the earth, and when it did, a third part of the rivers, it fell upon them. Verse 11 says this was the effects of it. And the name of the star is called Wormwood. And the third part of the waters became wormwood, which means bitter or poison. And many men died of the waters because they were made bitter. Now, wouldn't there have been a written account of such an event as this? That a meteorite or something of that nature struck this earth somewhere on the globe, and that when it did, it poisoned the waters, and that men that drank it died. It'd be a recorded event. It's never happened. Now, this is the verse that Baxter, according to his own testimony, says that he got, I think, the revelation that it was no longer a pre-tribulation doctrine such as we teach, but it had to be post, because he said this event has already happened. And somehow or another, in Ukraine, there's a little place called Chernobyl. In Ukraine, and there they have a nuclear power plant. And I believe it was maybe around April 26, 1986, I think, that it had a meltdown. They have to keep these nuclear reactors cooled, and they cannot let them get to a certain temperature or they will melt down. And then the radioactive particles that are contained within these facilities then will escape, and it is deadly. Radiation is deadly. Well, this happened, I think, on April 26th, I believe it was in 86, I believe. Anyway, they had a meltdown there in Ukraine, in Chernobyl, and there was a lot of people died from it. I reckon Baxter was studying, and somehow or another, he connected the word Chernobyl with Wormwood. And he linked the two together with Revelation 8 and 11. And he says he got a revelation that this was the third trumpet. That, I suppose, that he would say that the Lord was opening up the scriptures to him. And he got a revelation that Revelation 8 and 11 was speaking of the event in Chernobyl, Ukraine, April 26, 1986. And he even admits, I kind of got amused at him, he even admits that this was the third trumpet. He didn't know when the first two happened. So now what he did, he says he did this, he got into world history trying to find events as close as he could that would align to the blowing of the first trumpet and the blowing of the second trumpet. And the best he could come up with was World War II for trumpet number two. And then, like a light went off in his head, wow, if trumpet number two is World War II, then trumpet number one must be World War I. I'm telling you. And that's supposed to be his biblical proof that he is right and we are wrong. He is completely wrong. Absolutely is. None of those things are linked to this. This has not yet happened. We are not in the Great Tribulation period. Well, the thing about it is, most prophecies teach that the Great Tribulation period is only 7 years long. And I think it's been a little more than 7 years since 1986, ain't it? 86, 96, 2006. Why, it'd almost be 30 years since that's happened, right? I mean, if you can just count a little bit, you can destroy some of these fellows' doctrines. Well, I would imagine in April 26, next year, 2016, it will make 30 years. Well, the tribulation period itself ain't 7 years long. The thing about it is, you'd be surprised at the people that are following his teachings. I don't know whether it's, and I've run into several. And some of them friends of mine, man, they listen to him on TV, but they really don't want to get in and dig it out for themselves, so that requires work. When you study, it's work. Right? You ask anybody who's going to school, going to school, going to college, or taking college, it's work. Thank you. It's work to it. You got to dedicate yourself to study. I always hate this. If I does so poorly in school, I'm telling you, I was a straight D minus student. I'm so proud of that as any of these A plus students were. It got me through, and that was my goal. I wasn't looking for intelligence like the fellow said about his kid going to Christian school. Somebody was throwing off on his left. I don't plan on my boy being a nuclear physicist. No way. And which is true, my goal was to get through it, and thank God and my mother I got through it. Because it requires study. It's easy to sit and listen to a fellow on TV teach these things and say, look, Revelation 10 and 7 was William Marion Brown. I just listened to about an hour's message not long ago on this guy teaching on. And what caught my attention was, who was William Marion Brown? So I was curious. I already knew what was being said about him, where he's from, his life, and all that sort of thing. I want to know. So I listened for an hour of him declaring who William Marion Brown was. And then at the end, he said, and any of you fellows that speaks against him, you have blasphemed. So according to that gentleman, I'm a blasphemer because I spoke against not necessarily William Branham, the man, because I didn't know. It is possible that William Branham could have been a good man. Now, he wasn't right in everything he taught, but he was supposed to have converted from being a Baptist to Jesus' name, which was good, and believed in his latter years that baptism was performed in Jesus' name, all that sort of thing. He may have very well been a pretty good man. But his teachings, some of them were off. And some of the teachings that some of his followers, such as this nut, that's what I call Israel, he was a pure out nut, that was trying to tell us who William Marion Branham was, you know, and all this sort of thing. People, no doubt, have made more of him than he ever intended for himself. But I can imagine him, because I've listened to, I think he's got 900 and some messages on audio that you've listened to, that's William Branham. And I've seen TV clips of him and listened to him, listened to a lot of his teachings on different things, you know. And he was a well-read man. He wasn't that educated, but he kind of educated himself into the Word of the Lord. He did. And I think a lot of his followers, I can't imagine him in his own teaching saying, look, he taught that the church left in Revelation 4, 1 and 2. Why would he turn right around and teach that Revelation 10 and 7 was himself? That don't make sense, does it? But that's what I was trying to get across to my buddy. I said, you're not even teaching what Branham taught himself. And he knew he wasn't. But he couldn't deny Revelation 10 and 7 because that's their doctrine. That's William Branham. As they say back in the Old Testament, Malachi chapter 4, Malachi 4 and 5, that is William Branham also. I've been placed people with license plates, that's correct scripture. It's got, let's put it up and let's read it and see if I'm right. For all the people will walk, everyone in the name of his God, and we will walk in the name of the Lord our God. No, that wasn't 5, 3 and 5. No, that's Micah, Malachi. You're going to make me look bad. Malachi. I'm going to quit working for me one of these nights. They're just going to get up and just walk right out of that office. Ain't nobody going to be back. I'm going to be all by myself. I'll just have to float it. I'll just have to go to work. By the way, our machine back there is freezing up on them, too. So a lot of times when you see the screen go black, it's because it's froze up. They have to restart the whole thing. And she's froze on Micah somewhere. But anyway, the scripture does say, okay. Now, this is it. I was right, as usual. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And if you see license plates that says Malachi 4 and 5, what they're doing, they're identifying themselves as message people or followers of William Branham. Because they declare Malachi 4 and 5 as William Branham, as Revelation 10 and 7, that angel. I just threw that in there. It won't cost you nothing. Go ahead and get back on track. Revelation chapter 8, verse 11. I'm telling you, you've got to watch. There's a lot of wild doctrines out there. There really are. Somebody's got to tell you about them, so it must be me. Anyway, Baxter kind of, it's easy to find something in the Bible and go back in history to find something and say, well, this was it. You know, if you've ever heard of Nostradamus, anybody heard of him? And the quatrains that he wrote? Well, I've studied him too. And a lot of his works. And These people believe that. Don't believe none of that either. Nostradamus wasn't a prophet of God. And the things that they said he saw, if anything, would have been black magic, I would imagine. But anyway, let's finish this study. I can tell you wanting to go home. Do I have to shake your head? Yes. Your glory. All right. All right. I'll be with sugars after a day. I want to say. Verse 12 of Revelation chapter 8. And the fourth angel sounded, and the third part of the sun was smitten. That's never happened before. And the third part of the moon, and the third part of the stars, so as the third part of them was darkened, and the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. That's never happened. But there's an instance of darkness in Scripture. Exodus 10, verse 21, 22, and 23. And the Lord said unto Moses, stretch out thine hand toward the heaven, that there may be darkness over the land of Egypt, even darkness which may be felt. And Moses stretched forth his hand toward heaven, and there was a thick darkness in all the land of Egypt 3 days. They saw not one another, neither rose any from his place for 3 days, but all the children of Israel had light in their dwellings. So these things did happen. These are just to let us know that when he said it's going to happen on a global scale, it is going to happen. It really is. Back to Revelation 8 and verse 13. And I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of the heaven, saying with a loud voice, woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth by reason of the other voices of the trumpet of these three angels, which are yet to sound. And being the Lord's will, we'll study them in our next Bible study. But these things are certainly going to happen. If this Bible is true, and all of us in this house tonight, we believe that this Bible is true. We believe there is a God, and that He is in control and has never lost control. Despite what's going on in the world and in the Middle East, the hunger and starvation in third world countries and things of that nature, sicknesses and diseases that are throughout, we know that there is a God. And there is things that's recorded in this book that's going to happen. And true enough, one day, those that don't heed the call of God is going to wake up and be left behind. They will be left behind.